How much do I owe you?
$450, please.
Okay. So how much do I owe you?
$230.
Okay, here we go. I've got a 20.
I think I have 10 cents.
Did you say 25 cents?
There you go. Here you go. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right. It's that time of year when people are focused on money. As a matter of fact, some of us think about money all year long. So it's not a bad idea to figure out a way to spend less on food, especially without sacrificing flavor or nutrition. I have a few tricks up my sleeve to take some inexpensive ingredients and turn them into tasty meals that everyone will love.
Like this tasty Italian onion soup topped off with a tender poached egg, a hearty soup for supper. I serve it with a grilled radicchio salad. Now there's a meal. And I'll show you my foolproof method for making perfect poached eggs. Then my potato and greens pie, a pie filled with nutritious ingredients that cost pennies to make.
Budget stretching meal secrets to keep money in the bank and good food on the table. Today on Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Funding provided by
family-owned and Indiana-grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester, with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.
Hi, I'm Sara Moulton. Welcome to Sara's Weeknight Meals. The soup I'm about to make, Italian onion soup, was one of my favorites at a local restaurant we used to go to all the time called Beppe. The chef was Cesare Casella. It's no longer, alas, but I still remember this soup. And what's so great about it is it's onion soup, and you think of that as a French dish. But by the way, I've frozen my starting ingredient a little bit, pancetta, unsmoked bacon. It's easier to chop, and I'm going to start chopping it. But what made this soup so wonderful was that he topped it off with a poached egg and Parmesan cheese. Wow, it was just the best thing ever. So I decided, you know, this would be a great thing to make when I'm trying to save a few pennies. I mean, it's bulked up with onions. I mean, how much does 3 pounds of onions cost? Not a lot. Flavored with just a tiny bit of pancetta and a tiny bit of Parmesan. And yes, those are expensive ingredients, but a little goes a long way, and sometimes that's something to keep in mind. Go for the flavorful ingredients, just go for a very little bit. So the pancetta, I preheated my pan just to get this going a little faster. You could certainly use regular old bacon. Take it off the heat for half a second. You could leave the bacon out. You could use Canadian bacon. By the way, if you ever put a pan on the fire and you find that it got too hot, just pull it off. Just pull it off. It's so easy. And I'm gonna put it back on and turn it down. You know, it takes 8 to 12 minutes. If I started in a cold pan, it would take a full 12 minutes. So now on to the star of the show, the meaty part of the dish. That's not the meat, this is the meat. 3 pounds of onions. And a few tips about slicing onions. I don't know if you ever saw the Julie and Julia film. But there's a shot in there of Julia, you know, slicing mounds of onions for onion soup and just weeping, Julia Child. And, you know, that's a problem because that happens with onions. And the reason is that when you cut them with a dull knife, when you cut them at all, it's like you're disturbing their molecular nature and they give off these fumes. It's very complicated, much more complicated than I just said. And there's millions of sort of myths about what else you can do. And I'll tell you, really the only thing that works, and they are so sexy, are onion goggles. And I kid you not, years ago, except my trouble is then I think I'm wearing my glasses and I can focus. So basically I'm blind with my onion goggles on. But here's how I learned this. When I worked with Julia, she talked about, you put a match in your mouth, lighted or unlighted, I'd like to know, a piece of bread. You slice onions near cold running water. You have a fan blowing nearby. You put the onions in the cold part of the fridge. All those things are supposed to help. None of them help. None of them. Because they don't prevent the fumes. So one day I was doing the show and somebody had sent me a pair of welding goggles. This is, like 15 years ago. And I was like, well, that's really silly. And pretty also, they're not very attractive now, are they? But I put them on. We were doing an onion soup show. And wow, they really work. That's all I can tell you. So, okay, my pancetta is good. Oh, yes. You know, at this point, I think I can take them off. I was like, why can't I focus? It's very silly. I only pull them out when I'm doing that many onions, because less onions is not a problem. Oh, this looks so delicious. All right, so we're just gonna park this back here. And now we're gonna add some butter, 3 tablespoons. And then we're gonna get our onions in. And we're gonna do this very low and slow because we want the onions to really soften and really caramelize. So this is the one time you have to be patient. You know, something to do when you're reading the Sunday paper or you've got some sort of project to work on, but you can't rush them. I mean, you could rush them, but it just won't be as good. It's the low and slow cooking of the onions that makes them truly wonderful. Now, you're gonna be astonished. Look at that. That completely fills the pan, doesn't it? By the way, I'm gonna give them a nice hefty pinch of salt and pepper. It's important to season as you go. I'm just quick stir, and then the lid goes on, and I'm gonna cook these guys, stirring them every so often on very low heat for 20 minutes. At that point, I'm gonna take the lid off and give them another 30 minutes uncovered, and they will be dark and ready to go, nicely caramelized, and then we'll proceed. All right, you're not gonna believe this magic trick, how far down they went. You ready? Ripley's Believe It or Not. Ah! Where'd they go? Well, all they did was just get very, very, very yummy and oniony. It's a happy thing. At this point, okay, this is after 50 minutes, 20 covered, 30 uncovered, we are gonna add a cup of red wine and just reduce it down because we wanna get rid of that sort of harsh wine taste. And then we're gonna add some beef broth in half a second. But in the meantime, oh yeah, I'm just gonna scrape up all that caramelized stuff at the bottom of the pan. Okay, so, wow, that's just about there. I'm gonna get my grated, my Parmesan out for grating. So we have some Parmigiano Reggiano, which is again, just a little, goes a long way. All we need is about a half a cup. I'm gonna grate it right onto some parchment. And what's great about Parmigiano Reggiano is it stores really well in the refrigerator. You keep it wrapped in parchment paper and then put that in a loose plastic bag and it will keep for a long time. And when you get all the way down to the rind, you're just about down here, there's nothing left, save that. It's a wonderful flavoring for soups. You know, this is already reduced so much, I'm gonna add my broth. We've got about 5 to 6 cups of broth, 5 1/4 cups. And this is supermarket beef broth. There's a few brands that come out that I've liked, finally. You could also just use chicken broth, either homemade or your favorite brand from the supermarket. So I'm gonna grate a little bit of cheese here quickly with a microplane. My daughter Ruthie loves Parmesan cheese. She would throw this in the soup, she would throw it on top, she'd throw it on the side, we'd have extra, 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 because she just loves it. And the cheese provides not only a lovely cheese Parmesan flavor, but it's also sort of some salt too. So we're going to be careful with the salt. We don't want to have an overly salty soup. So there's our cheese. And I'm going to just set it aside. So this is now going to come up to a boil and simmer for about 20 minutes. There we go. While that is simmering, I'm going to focus on eggs. I'm going to poach some eggs. Now, this has been, at times, a very scary thing for people because you've been you just feel like it's so easy, that it's so hard, they break apart easily. Here's how, I'll tell you the way I was taught to do it. First, let me just say, a pot with water, you know, coming up about that high. I'm going to put about a half a cup, quarter cup of vinegar. The vinegar helps the egg white to set up so you don't have that sort of stringy white, you know, how it sort of shreds. A nice pinch of salt. Okay, these are good fresh eggs. Recently, I learned a new trick by straining the egg first through a strainer. The watery stuff goes through. You see that watery stuff in there? And the viscous egg stays right in there. I'm putting them in little ramekins so that I can drop them in at the same time. If you try to do this with an egg, I've had so many disasters that way. I just break the yolk or it just falls in the wrong way. And then you very gently put it in the ramekins. So as soon as that comes up to a boil, I'm going to turn it off and add the eggs. The way I was taught to make poached eggs, which is so stressful, would be to take a spoon, right? And you'd make a whirlpool. And then you'd quick get your spoon out and drop the egg in the middle of the whirlpool and hope that the white would wrap around the yolk. That made me so nervous. And then one day I was doing a show with a very cute Australian chef, and he did what I'm about to do. You bring this up to a boil, you turn it off. Okay, you put your eggs in gently. You put the lid on and you leave it for 4 minutes. That is what we are going to do. So what happens when an egg is harvested is from that moment onwards, even though the shell is a shell and you would think, well, that's a protection to the inside of the egg, it actually is permeable. Air gets through. The older the egg, the bigger the air pocket. Have you ever tried to peel an egg and you just couldn't peel it? That's because there was no air pocket because it was too fresh an egg. An old egg is good for hard-boiled eggs. The younger an egg, the less of an air pocket. Let's say your carton of eggs got separated from the carton. You want to figure out how old they are. Are they okay to eat? A really fresh egg, these happen to be a particular kind, so they're green. A really fresh egg, because it has no air pocket or very little, when you put it into water, it lies flat because there's nothing to make it float or even stand up. As an egg gets older, it'll start to stand up in water, and eventually, if it's really old, This is like shocking. Are you ready for this one? Ready? It'll float. That's an egg that perhaps you want to toss. Although I'm sure it wouldn't quite kill you. I wanted to show you very quickly, and then I bet you my poached eggs are done, what these look like after you break them. Now look at that. Almost that whole white is wet. You see that? There's two parts. There's a little bit of viscous white here, and that is all watery. Here's a fresh egg, and look at the difference. You see how much of that is very viscous right here? The only watery part is here. Also, you'll notice that the yolk stands up higher. It's in better shape. It's a younger egg. Oh dear, that's a terrible thing when we think about what that means for all of us. Oh, look at those beautiful guys. Let me just get him out on some paper towel. We want to get rid of that excess water. Wow. Now let me say, wow, that's just beautiful, that if you don't do the straining business or if they have little stray whites coming out the edge, what you can do is chill them. Sometimes I just put them in a bowl of ice and water if I make a whole bunch ahead of time, and then to reheat them I just dip them in here. But after I've chilled them, you can take a pair of scissors and just trim off those like little spidery white bits. Okay, we are ready to go. I'm just going to finish off my soup. take a little tiny taste. It gets some cognac, yum, yum. And I'm gonna put my pancetta back in. Oh, that's so good. Oh, it's so essence of onion. Okay, just a little bit. You could leave the cognac out too, but that's sort of classic in a soup. Okay, pancetta back in. Wow. I think I'll go with 2 eggs. Eggs are so substantial as well. They're very affordable. And it gives you the protein. They're a terrific source of protein. So even though we're not really getting a lot of protein, well, we're not at all with the onions, we will with the poached eggs. Okay, they're gonna sink a little bit, but I wanna get the whole thing ready. A nice topping for this would be some chopped fresh parsley. Should I go with 2 eggs? Yeah, I'm gonna go with 2 eggs. One would get lonely. The Parmesan cheese, and you see you break the egg in there, and then it sort of, all the yolk comes out and sort of thickens the onions even more. It's just so wonderful. And we've got the perfect accompaniment here, some nice toasted bread. So there you go, my very elegant Italian onion soup for no money at all. When I was working in the test kitchen at Gourmet in the mid-80s and something didn't quite look right, we would either say it was made with human hands or it was rustic. And I've always loved that saying, particularly when it comes to pastry, because I am pastry impaired. So the pie that I'm making today, which is a wonderful potato and greens pie, is perfect because it doesn't have to look perfect. So we're going to start by getting the onions into the pan to soften, and then we'll add our greens to that. Olive oil. This is a Mediterranean style pie. I'm going to add a pinch of salt. It's a good idea to season as you go. So let's look at the greens that we've got today. And this is an enormous amount of greens. It's actually 2 pounds, but it looks like a lifetime supply now, doesn't it? And we've got a mixture here today that we're using of mustard greens, which I personally love because they've got that sort of bite of mustard in them. And then we've also got some collards, which are a little tougher, take a little longer to cook. So I'm going to give this a quick chop, these greens. Greens in general have folic acid, they have fiber, they have potassium, they have iron. I mean, yikes, why not? I'm going to say my onions are just about there, yep. So let me add the garlic. And then we're gonna get our greens in. We've got some minced garlic here. That's 2 garlic cloves. And half of our greens are gonna go in. And we want a fairly high temperature because I'm gonna wilt this quickly. I don't want it to steam. I'm gonna do it in 2 batches. While that is wilting away, I'm gonna drain my potatoes. Now we started the potatoes in cold water, which is how you should start all root vegetables. And the reason for that is so that they cook evenly throughout. If you started them in hot water, they would get very soft on the outside before they were cooked on the inside. I'm using Yukon Gold. You could use Red Bliss. You really could use any potato you wanted to. The advantage of boiling potatoes, which are the thin skin variety, is that you don't have to peel them. Go back to my greens. What we're really doing here, besides giving it a head start and cooking, is we're trying to get rid of the excess liquid. If we put raw greens into the pie, we would end up with a wet pie, and that's the last thing we want. I'm gonna add a little more oil, get the rest of the greens in, and do the same for round 2. Season as you go. And then I'm gonna mash my potatoes. Okay. This was my husband's potato masher when I first met him in college. He used to be a terrific cook when I first met him. And then I went off to cooking school and became so obnoxious, telling him he was doing everything wrong, that he stopped cooking. Oh my gosh, there's just nothing sadder than that. I would be happy now if he made me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. So I'm gonna put the greens in here and then add the potatoes right to this and then get started on my cheese. You know, I'm gonna pop this in a fridge for 2 seconds while I grate my cheese just to cool it down. Hang on 1 second. This is Gruyere cheese. There's 3 cheeses I'm putting in here. Ricotta cheese, Parmesan cheese, and Gruyere cheese. I just love it because it's got a rich, buttery, nutty taste. So we have 1 ounce of Parmigiano Reggiano, 2 ounces of Gruyere, and 1 cup of ricotta cheese. And then we're gonna add some eggs as well, which will be our binder. So now I'm gonna beat 2 eggs. We're gonna save a little bit to go on the top as an egg wash. Okay, here we go. So here we have our Parmesan, freshly grated, good stuff, our ricotta, Gruyere, and now I'm gonna add my nutmeg. You do have to be careful because a little bit of nutmeg goes a long way. Most of the egg, I gotta try to save about a tablespoon. See, I'm even mixing this rustically. The proportions aren't all that fixed in stone. Boy, it looks really pretty now. All right, I'm gonna call this done. Park it in the fridge again while I roll out my dough. So I am gonna roll out some dough that I made ahead of time. It's my basic butter dough. You could use a store-bought dough. But this recipe is so easy, you could do it. But you want to chill it after you make it so that all the gluten relaxes in the dough and also so the butter chills, because when this bakes, the butter's going to melt, create steam, and that's what's going to make the pie dough puff up. So keep your counter well floured. You can use all-purpose flour, you can use whole wheat flour, half whole wheat, half all-purpose. You can also use white whole wheat flour, which is sort of cool because for some crazy reason, the reason kids, I think, don't like whole wheat flour is because they don't like the color, because they don't like the brownness of it. But with the white whole wheat flour, you don't have to worry about that. So I'm just starting, like Julia, to get it softened. And then once we get it started, we can start rolling. And what we're gonna do, you always wanna keep it moving so that you don't work the gluten. If your dough starts to soften, which this is, don't panic. Just pop it in the fridge if you can for a minute, and it will be fine. Don't stretch it, ease it into the corners. You're like, wow, that looks horrible. Don't worry. Now I'm gonna put the filling in the pie dough and just mound it up. So we're gonna fold in the edges in a rustic fashion. Ta-da! Perfect! No sweat! Perfect for the pastry impaired. Doesn't this look like your grandmother made it? Your Italian grandmother. So we've preheated the oven to 375. I'm gonna just put this on a sheet pan and pop it in the oven for about 40 minutes or until the filling is heated through and the crust is gonna get wonderfully golden. That egg wash was just to give it a nice extra golden color. See, I told you it would look beautiful. Now this needs to rest for about 10 minutes before you cut into it, just so it finishes cooking and sets up. But then you can dig right in. And what I want to serve with it here today is a tomato salad with sprouts. I like to serve salads with cheesy dishes or bready dishes. I think the acid in the dressing really helps to cut through the flatness of this, although this is delicious, don't get me wrong. So see how nicely that came out? And if I, the pastry impaired, can do it, so can you. And what a delicious meal on a weeknight. I'm Sara Moulton, thanks for joining me, and I'll see you next time on Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Sara's Weeknight Meals continues online. For recipes, helpful tips, messages, and lots more, visit us on the web at saramoulton.com/weeknightmeals.
Funding provided by
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester, with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.